Welcome to the Shemane Show.
I feel so welcome to every show, but especially the Shemane Show. By the way, have I told you how much I love you lately?
No, you haven't. Well, you did this morning.
And this morning, and about 15 minutes ago. By the way, everybody, my name is Ted Nugent, and I'm in love with Shemane.
Aw. So today we are talking about more absurd hunting laws, and we are here in Michigan. Beautiful, beautiful September day. The sun is shining bright. The trees are just starting to turn color. There's a cool breeze when we're walking around the woods with our dogs, and it's just glorious.
It really is magic. We call it the spirit of the wild. No, I was born in Detroit in 1948 when it was the arsenal of democracy, and Michigan was the number one hunting state. And let me quick review of the tradition and the incredible conservation, wise use, reverence for God's renewable resources that we spearheaded in this country, because it was a marketing slaughter. Just whatever you could kill, you could sell. Right up until the late 1800s, when Teddy Roosevelt and John Hornady stepped in and went, wait a minute, the government is intentionally killing all the bison, the North American bison, to help destroy the Native Americans' life, their spirits' life, and their tools and medicine and shelter, clothing, food. And so Theodore Roosevelt, who was a hunter and realized that you're only supposed to kill the surplus every year so that you never negatively affect the basic population of any game species, because they do produce every year, but the habitat does not expand to accommodate the support for the new production of wildlife every year. So we harvest it to eat it. And that's how mankind has sustained ourselves, by eating the meat and using the skins for clothing and shelter and the tools and the bones and the sinew. And we literally cherish the wildlife that provides us life's sustenance. So the hunters stepped in and went, you can't just market slaughter anymore, unregulated, discriminate slaughter. We've got to have seasons and bag limits, and you have to buy a license so we can pay for conservation officers and science-based game departments so that we never negatively impact the basic nucleus resource. A passenger pigeon died off because it was a flock animal, and a virus overtook them and killed them all. And the bison was almost exterminated to try to destroy the Native Americans' life. But hunters stepped in and went, no, no more slaughter. We have to regulate hunting. Okay, good idea. Yeah, the moose and the elk and the caribou and the pronghorn, the deer and these animals, the bear, the cougar, they will produce X amount. We know exactly what that science is. So each year we can harvest X surplus to sustain the wildlife through the winter so they don't devastate their habitat. Eating this whole brand new crop of animals will eat their habitat down to nothing if the surplus is not harvested responsibly. So we hired game departments based on sustained yield, population dynamic, carrying capacity, the winter severity index, the impact on attrition in the wildlife. And we are celebrating in 2022 what has developed into the most revered wildlife management model in the history of mankind. More deer than ever in recorded history, more turkey than ever in recorded history, more bears, more black bears and cougar and geese than ever in recorded history, because hunters pay for the management model of sustained yield. That being said, bureaucrats propagate and overpopulate worse than deer that are not hunted. So bureaucrats have infested every game department, in fact, every bureaucracy in government. And you see the outcome of that with Joe Biden. You see the abuse of power. You see the IRS hiring all these armed commandos to harass mom and pop businesses to get their taxes so we can send trillions of dollars to Ukraine, spend trillions of dollars to Planned Parenthood and public television so that they can propagandize and brainwash people. So my point is, we are now way beyond taxation without representation. And what does that have to do with wildlife management and the insane regulations? I'm getting to that, because I had to lay that groundwork that let run amok, bureaucrats will torch your tax dollars. And what you and I could accomplish with 10 people, a government agency will hire 10,000.
Do you think that any of this could have been prematurely sought out. Like, they designed this to happen right now. More government control means less freedoms that we have. More government control means less hunting rights that you have and I have. And I wonder if back in the Roosevelt days, they thought about this. Wow, if we make all these regulations, pretty soon we'll have it so that they can't go put their, they can't go hunting without putting their bow in a case or putting their gun in a case and transporting it and all these other absurd hunting laws. Or do you think it was just a case of, you know, we started out with good intentions and we let them, we allowed the government to take more and more control every year?
I wish my wife, Shemane, would teach history in every center of learning in America. How about that back then, the deep state was already being created, the Illuminati, the International Monetary Fund. They were already deep into this, trying to control the citizens. There's no question that there's a parallel. I don't know if Teddy Roosevelt was part of that scam and part of that criminality to control humanity. Because the most wildlife regulations nowadays are not about wildlife management. They're about people management. And here's a perfect example. Everybody knows that deer eat corn and apples and acorns. Deer eat stuff. I don't have a biology degree, but I concluded that deer eat stuff. And they eat agriculture. They eat soybeans and they eat alfalfa and they eat hay and clover and they eat apples from the apple orchards. Deer eat stuff. Well, even if I didn't pick an apple and put it close to my tree stand, the deer still eat apples. Well, here in the state of Michigan and some of the states like Illinois, boy, talking about corrupt states, Michigan is now the laughingstock in the nation. Went from the number one hunting state in the nation to the laughingstock where you have to have your bow in a case. Well, what role does a bow case play other than keeping your bow clean? And why would the government care whether your bow was clean or not? Now, I got rid of that law with the great Tom Leonard. And we fought against that so that we could do in Michigan what they do in every other state except Illinois, maybe New Jersey.
So just for purposes of hunting 101, somebody who has never been exposed to hunting and they don't understand what you're even talking about, in order to go hunting in every other state but Michigan, you
and
can,
Illinois.
And Illinois.
Yeah, you can throw your bow in the back seat of your truck.
Right.
And why not?
Right. But in Michigan, you're special.
Yes.
You have special laws.
Again, I got rid of that law, but Illinois and probably some other states are still plagued with this absurdity there. The bureaucrats will see how much they can get away with in controlling people. So you had to, by law, have your bow in a case if it's in a vehicle. Well, I'm driving to my ranch to go hunting. I'll throw my bow in the back seat. Or maybe I'll put it on the bumper. But whose business is it how I transport my bow? Well, in many states, and how about this? California is not one of the states where you have to have your gun in a case when you're deer hunting.
So there's stricter laws in Michigan
yes.
than there are in California.
Yes.
Like I said, is this planned or what?
Well, whether it's planned or not, I'm fighting it. For example, in Michigan, the number one game animal on planet Earth, and everybody should follow me on this, more family hours of recreation and more revenues are generated by the annual mourning dove hunting season. The mourning dove is the most hunted thing on planet Earth. We kill tens of, maybe hundreds of millions of doves. There's billions and billions of dollars spent on licenses, supplies, sporting goods, ammo, coolers, ice, beer, grills, you know, propane, trucks, cornfields and sunflower seeds so we can hunt doves. And we kill and eat the surplus of dove productivity every year, because if not, they will devastate entire regions of flora and fauna when they overpopulate. So we make sure they don't overpopulate. We kill them and grill them. Well, the dove is produced in more numbers in Michigan than there are woodcock, grouse, pheasant, and quail combined. But Michigan lies. The Michigan Department of Natural Resources and Gretchen Whitmer and this Nestle girlfriend of hers and the Natural Resource Commission, they lie. They claim that the picture of that dove on the shotgun shell box that says game load, dove and quail shotgun ammo, Michigan Department of Natural Resource will lie and call it a songbird. While the rest of the nation is spending billions of dollars on food and transportation, restaurants and groceries and supplies, and having great family hours of recreation in the comfortable weather of September, Michigan forbids it, even though we grow more doves than some of those other hunting states. And here's the proof that bureaucrats have no soul. That's quite a cocky statement. And here's the proof that supports that cocky statement that bureaucrats have no soul. The federal migratory game bird, the ribeye, it's called the ribeye. The sandhill crane is known as the ribeye in the sky. There are tens of millions of them. And it's hunted in those states that have populations that are huntable to keep it from overrunning its habitat. Michigan's agriculture is devastated by the many millions of dollars in loss every year because of the sandhill crane overpopulation. The sandhill crane is a federal migratory game bird known as a ribeye in the sky. To prove that bureaucrats are immoral, in the state of Michigan, we finally got them to admit that the sandhill crane is devastating agriculture, costing farmers millions of dollars. So they allow us to shoot them, but the law forbids us to eat the ribeye in the sky. The law says you can kill that sandhill crane, but you must let it rot in the field. Now, when a bureaucrat gets that deep into the immorality, I can no longer obey anything they say, because they are immoral. I, on the other hand, am moral. And when I shoot a sandhill crane, you're damn right I'm going to eat it. It's known as a ribeye in the sky. I don't waste precious protein from a game animal. And it goes on and on and on.
A lot of people will be shaking their heads, and they just can't comprehend the words that just came out of your mouth. But there's one that's even more ridiculous that you have experienced recently, and share with everybody what you now have to do for government regulation for the state of Michigan when you are hunting.
Michigan was the number one deer hunting state in the nation with over 1 million licensed hunters when I was growing up. And because of the absurd, arbitrary, punitive, capricious overregulations, we have lost 50% of our hunting population in Michigan. The guys got busted and fined for having their bow out of a case and their on their ATV.
And friends of ours who will remain nameless got caught shooting 3 minutes after sunset.
Yes.
And got a fine.
Yes.
The water fountain. Who's stalking them? Whose job is it to come after hunters? I mean,
bureaucrats with no soul that are just jackbooted thugs. And those that aren't jackbooted thugs, I'm not talking about you. But if you enforce a law that says I can't eat a ribeye in the sky, you are an immoral individual. Now in the state of Michigan, Fred Bear and Roy Case in Wisconsin, we created the new sensational ultimate samurai martial arts, the martial arts of the mystical flight of the arrow. And we started an early archery season because the deer numbers were expanding exponentially across the nation once the timber was cut and the habitat grew up where the deer could hide better and eat it better. And so the deer numbers were getting out of hand, so we needed to expand the harvest. And Fred Bear and Roy Case, we created an early, quiet, comfortable archery season in October before the guns go off and causing the deer to become a little bit more spooky and nocturnal. But the bow hunting is quiet. It's better weather, more attractive to people who might not want to put up with a blizzard during the gun season. And so the numbers of licenses went up, but that was because it was the early bow season before the guns start going off. Well, now in the state of Michigan, we have an early youth season, and nobody loves the youth more than I do. I want to get these kids in the sport. But the early youth season starts with firearms in early September. So much for a quiet archery season. And then the next weekend, and nobody supports the vets better more than we do. We love our veterans. But they have a veterans gun season the next weekend in September. Well, the biology of deer hunting is when can you start to harvest to be as attractive as possible for people to invest in the licenses and supplies. And most states, more and more states are opening September 1st because the fawns are almost done lactating. They're eating solid foods. They're certainly independent by September 1st. So more and more people are enjoying that early season. But once in Michigan, when the guns go off for a weekend for the youth, then you can't hunt on Monday. And then the next weekend, you can hunt with guns for the veterans, but you can't hunt on Monday. And then the next weekend, you got the early firearms doe season, but you can't hunt on Monday. Well, wait a minute. If it's biologically sound to start in that early September, then what's biologically sound doesn't stop after the weekend. So they're causing people to quit the sport. And here's the newest outrage.
And that if that weren't bad enough, here's the one that I was talking about.
If that weren't bad enough. So now the DNR pulls out of their bureaucrat ass that you have to go to this website and register how you killed your deer, exactly GPS where you killed your deer, what the sex and gender and of your deer was, and you have to provide all the license information to the DNR. Well, I tried to comply after shooting some does during the early firearm season. I use my bow and arrow because I try to, on our property, we do try to keep things quiet. And bows and arrows are quiet. And it causes less pressure on the deer. So we like to see more deer. And of course, when the guns start going off, the deer become more nocturnal and more difficult to kill. And the DNR wants them dead. The highway department wants them dead. The insurance companies want them dead. The agriculture department wants them dead. The soup kitchens want them dead. I want them dead. We have to kill a bunch of deer to save the habitat and make room for next year's productivity. Well, I tried to go to the website and type in my license number and type in the deer I killed and what I killed it with. And I tried to go to the map and pinpoint where I killed it, and the map wouldn't let me go there. So I struggled to fill out my required deer kill report. And after a half an hour, I've got my nightly Nuge recording to do. I have my Ted Nugent Spirit Campfire I have to record. I got a life. I got to take my dogs hunting. I got to work on my truck. I got to call my kids. I got to talk to my son, Toby, and my guides for the hunters that are coming in this weekend. I have a life. And I got so pissed off that I just gave up. And I called the DNR and I left this message. I called the deer specialist. He's a good man for a bureaucrat. I think he knows his deer hunting, but he's become more and more of a deercrat. And I like Chad Stewart. And I like him even more this afternoon than I did this morning. So I left a message for Chad and I said, Chad, this is Ted Nugent calling. It is September 19th at 9 a.m. I went to the Department of Natural Resources deer check-in report site and I tried to comply with this new regulation. It wouldn't let me offer the information pertaining to the deer that I killed. And I'm sick and tired of this. What could you possibly need this information for? We've had a wonderful deer hunting season in Michigan for the last 100-plus years, and now I'm forced to go to a website, and every time I kill a deer, I got to report exactly where and the number that's on the tag. You guys sold me the tag. You know what number's on there. You already got that. And I said, maybe Peter ought to talk to Paul in your office. And I said, I'm not doing this. And I hung up. Well, much to Chad's respect, he did call back and we had a nice conversation. He understood and he says, they're not going to enforce the, I don't know if I'm supposed to share this or not, but he said, nobody's going to harass you or give you a problem or a ticket if you don't meet the 72-hour reporting deadline. And I said, well, Chad, then why does it exist? What are you going to do with this information?
Do you know what it feels like to me? It's very similar to what happened with the lockdowns and the pre-pandemic or during the pandemic. We had to wear masks. We had to stand 6 feet apart. People were even wiping off their grocery bags. It's sort of a
insane
way to get you to comply. And
well, I have a hat that says Ted Nugent logo. I will not comply. If you tell me to do something that I know is wrong, immoral, or stupid, I will not comply. You can get these hats, Ted Nugent, I will not comply hat, and the flag at TedNugent.com. You should go there. Great gift for people who really believe in truth, logic, and common sense. but I will not comply. I'm Rosa Parks. You can't tell me I can't sit on any seat on that bus I so choose. And that's where we are right now. And you're right, Shemane. When they start forcing you to wear a mask that they know damn well and they finally admit it didn't work, when they force you to take a shot that they call a vaccine because by the CDC's own website, we'll use the term vaccine because people are comfortable with it. Well, back in Nuremberg in 1938, Jewish people were comfortable with the idea of getting a shower, and they forced them on a train. They lied to them. And I know this isn't Auschwitz and this is not the Holocaust, but that's the incrementalism that power-abusing criminal bureaucrats have always used throughout history. And if they tell you to do something stupid, defy them. Americans are supposed to be like Ted Nugent. The founding fathers wanted every American to be just like me. Critical thinking, suspicious of all authority, and to review directives and mandates and regulations and put them through your intellectual filter and decide whether these mandates and decrees and regulations make any sense whatsoever. And I'm not the smartest man in the world, but I'm also not the dumbest sheep in the world. And if you tell me to do something really stupid, I will not comply. Case closed.
It's amazing that we're even having this conversation because we've absolutely lost the First Amendment. Absolutely. There's no question about it. We can't say what we did, or 2 years ago anyway, we couldn't say what we did to help get over COVID when we did have that flu virus. We couldn't talk about simple things like taking vitamins and getting vitamin D naturally through the sunshine and having a good diet and exercising. Nobody was giving anybody any preemptive opportunities to, hey, take care of your health.
Yeah,
so you're not going to get sick. And now look, it's just like we give them an inch and they go a mile. And that's why so many people, Ted, are suspicious right now.
Well, they should be suspicious, remain defiant, remain critical thinking. The great Josh Hawley from Missouri, he grilled the big tech guy. I think his name was Chris Cox. And the big tech guy finally admitted that they had a strategy with the FBI and the Biden administration to intentionally censor conservative thought.
Yeah,
he
so
admitted it on record.
And so did Zuckerberg.
Yes.
Came out. Why do you think that Zuckerberg would come out and say that on Joe Rogan's show?
Well, number one, Joe Rogan is a great conversationalist and a great interviewer and a great podcast. I was proud to share that Joe Rogan podcast with him twice. But he got Zuckerberg to admit, plus Zuckerberg's a jerk. Zuckerberg might be brilliant when it comes to certain technologies, but when it comes to humanism, the guy is brain dead and soulless. And he finally burped up the truth that his big tech company was taking away First Amendment rights from Americans. Good work, Zuckerberger.
But then now what? There's no accountability. Nobody's going after him. Of course, it's like
unbelievable.
They get away with everything. Speaking of getting away, I know you have a date.
I have a date with a tree.
With a tree, and you need to get away. So I'm going to let you go. But I wanted you to share these absurd hunting laws with so many people who aren't aware of it because, you know, what if something happens? What if the grid goes down and people want to learn more about hunting? They've got to start now. They've got to pick up a bow and arrow. And women, please do not go to an archery shop, pick up a bow and arrow, and let them tell you you need to shoot a 40 or 50 or 60 pound bow.
Yeah.
It's just not necessary. I shoot everything with 30 pounds, have
30
killed
pounds.
30 pounds, wildebeest, zebra, whitetail, owdad.
Oh, big giant owdad, yep. Oryx, 650 pound Oryx arrow in and out, 30 pound Matthews bow. Archery is about stealth and grace. If you struggle to pull the bow back, that's not archery.
Yep. Well, you've got a date and I'm going to let you go. So thank you so much for sharing your immense wisdom about hunting and hunting laws and history with us here on The Shemane Show.
Thank you. I love to be a part of The Shemane Show. Everybody join me at the Ted Nugent Real America's Voice Spirit Campfire. And every night of the week, the Ted Nugent Nightly Nuge. I don't know how you get there, but find it. It's really glorious truth, logic, and common sense. Thank you, honey. I love you.
Aw, I love you too. And I love all of you who are listening. I really do. You know, you're probably here because you're skeptical about things that are going on in this world, and you should be. thank you for speaking out, for sharing your voice with others. Now, some of you might think that your voice doesn't matter, but it does. God picked you to be here for such a time as this. We can't wait for President Trump or anyone else to save us. God chose you and me to spread his message. You know, I love Proverbs 31:25. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. That just buoys my spirit. And next week, I got to tell you, I'm going to start a short series on women warriors. We're going to do a deep dive into why we need strong women to stand up and to make their voices heard. We'll talk about scripture, and we're going to dive deep into spiritual warfare targeted just towards women. Thanks for listening, everybody. Please share this with at least one person. You never know who might need to hear these words. Check out the show notes for more details about this show. And sign up for my email list at shemanenugent.rocks. That's shemanenugent.rocks. Don't forget to rate, subscribe, and review this show if you haven't already. That helps others find us. Stay healthy and happy, my friends. You're going to need a lot of energy for the weeks and months ahead. Email me at wildlywell21@gmail.com for more information about the superfood nutrition Ted and I take for supernatural health. God bless. I'll see you right here every Tuesday and Thursday.